production of Imagine KC is made possible by the generous support of the Hall Family Foundation, the Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, the Garney Family Foundation Fund, Lafarge North America, the Urban Land Institute of Kansas City, and the Kansas City chapter of the American Institute of Architects. Imagine KC is a co-production of KCPT and the Mid-America Regional Council.
Welcome back to Imagine KC, a series that explores the ways that communities throughout the metro are becoming more vibrant, connected, and green. In this episode, we'll take a look at the concept of vibrant centers. The Kansas City region has excellent examples of vibrant centers, places that allow us to live, shop, find entertainment, enjoy the outdoors, and work, all within walking distance or a short car ride. Certainly, we have the Plaza as the gold star standard for quality design. But recently, we've seen revitalization in the Crossroads District. Independence Square has literally knocked down walls to bring back the Truman-era center, and downtown Overland Park has supplemented its farmers market with a new community center, condos, and retail to create the beginnings of a true town center. So, as the demographics of our region change, communities recognize that new strategies are required to plan for the future. We'll look at the key characteristics of successful centers and how quality design principles from our past are resurfacing to make this region a more vibrant place. It's all coming up on this episode of Imagine KC. We'll start with something that's not uncommon, the desire to revitalize historic downtowns. In our first episode, we saw one example in Lee's Summit. If you missed it, visit our website at imaginekc.org. But in this episode, we'll head across the river to Leavenworth to see what's happening there to enhance livability for its residents.
Leavenworth is a unique community. First off, we're the first city in the state of Kansas. So we've got a lot of old housing stock here. We also have a large presence of federal agencies. We have Fort Leavenworth, which is the combined arms center, what we refer to as the intellectual center of the Army.
But mostly it's the community. It's a very warm community.
Well, taking a stroll down our downtown, I think you'll find a more diverse population than just about any other city in the metropolitan area. We have some amazingly talented people here. We have some interesting, charming, and unique shops. We've got, you know, restaurants that have cuisine from around the world. We've got beautiful architecture and wonderful people, just all in all. So it's definitely a community that has potential, and that I think with all of us working together towards a common goal, we'll be able to see that potential.
Well, I think we're looking at the assets that we have. Let's call it a rejuvenation of some of our assets. The downtown is a large Main Street development. It's larger than most and encompasses 7 blocks going east to west and 4 to 5 blocks going north to south.
We have over 244 businesses downtown, more than 90 retailers downtown. We're a full service downtown.
It's along a river. It's got unique characterizations. It's got an awful lot of historic buildings downtown that are being rejuvenated at this present time. You don't find that in a lot of other cities, especially the newer cities.
The original city fathers didn't have, you know, zoning experience and architectural planning experience or even urban design experience. What they had was, you know, what works. If you look at some of these pictures, you'll notice that there was generally not a piece of dirt that didn't have a building on it. That's good for the entrepreneur. They obviously have many options and spaces available. It's great for the residents, but it's also great for our property tax base. It's definitely something that, you know, we want that walkability and that livability that we used to have back in the, you know, mid-1800s. We want that back.
And able to increase our patronage downtown, we need to have something that brings people downtown, like a hotel and conference center. The other thing we certainly want to concentrate on is more housing in the downtown.
We are working hard to develop our upper stories. We have many fantastic lofts, which can be seen during our loft tour in July. We also have upper story business as well, office space, meeting spaces, and we have a number of buildings that have that potential.
We have over a 95% occupancy rate right now for the loft apartments that we have in downtown. And so to add on to that, and to kind of continue with that redevelopment theme, we were able to take a large industrial complex that we all kind of refer to as Tire Town, but historically was known as the Great Western Stove Manufacturing Company, and work with our friends over at the EPA and the state of Kansas in a lot of remediation, but that process is now complete, and so we've handed those buildings over to a residential and commercial developer who is looking at both providing lofts and condos for our downtown area, as well as a little bit of additional commercial space for offices and potentially even restaurant.
Hi, I'm Stacy McCowan, and I'm the owner and the candle queen of Candle Queen Candles. I pour my own candles, and we're located in Leavenworth, Kansas. I have found that the city has really helped, and they are very open to anything you're doing and just really on board. They really want the town to grow, and they have grants that you can get, and we were accepted for one of the grants.
The 50-50 matching grant program allows for city assistance up to $5,000 to encourage businesses to improve their buildings, not just to repair them, but to actually do things that aesthetically improves them. And as a result of that program, we've seen over $100,000 in local investment above and beyond the matching portion of the city. So it's been a successful program since its inception.
The more that's going on in downtown, the more it draws people, the more vibrant it is. And especially now that we have a little restaurant behind us, the Peacock Cafe, and the mural outside, and then all the little chairs out there from the Peacock Cafe, it's really already increased business just in the last month with all of the excitement going on.
Just beyond the bustle of Leavenworth's historic downtown, the city is hoping to capitalize on another asset to fortify its future.
To date, and we're also working with a master developer on 18 acres for a research and technology park.
This, we hope, will be a direct support to Fort Leavenworth. At the current time, we have a lot of contractors that work for Fort Leavenworth throughout the city, located wherever we can find room for them.
If we can provide office space here in Leavenworth, for them to accommodate their offices and work right across from the front door of Fort Leavenworth, I think that would be advantageous to the city.
Although Leavenworth is just starting down the trail of redevelopment, all of those involved see the shining possibilities that lay ahead.
Jobs. Once this is completely done and developed, I want to see jobs. I want to see more retail, commercial, and community involvement, community spirit to be lifted.
Enrich our historic preservation, provide for the needs, the retail needs of the shopper.
We encourage folks to live downtown, to take a look at the lofts downtown, because when they work and live downtown, they also play downtown, they shop downtown, they eat downtown. That whole vibrancy comes through.
With downtown Leavenworth being successful, each one of those downtowns surrounding the Kansas City metropolitan area being successful, it leads to a more successful Kansas City. It's one of our greatest joys, I think, to see people taking advantage of the new streetscape downtown or the new Three Mile Creek and walking their dogs, riding their bikes, shopping in our stores, and really being out there and living and working and playing in the community that they call home.
Learn more about plans for downtown Leavenworth at our website, imaginekc.org. But what if you're a city that didn't have a downtown to begin with? In some of our region's older bedroom suburbs, city officials, residents, and developers alike have recognized the lack of prominent centers in their community and are now doing something about it. Case in point, Gladstone, Missouri.
Post-World War II, we engaged in a massive project of suburbanization around this country. We've now got a lot of communities that are really beginning to show their age. Many of them have been leapfrogged to newer and newer development. Their values have gone down. And so a lot of those first-ring suburbs, instead of seeing themselves as suburbs on the edge of downtown, now they've got a tremendous opportunity to reinvent themselves.
Just north of Casey, Gladstone is one of those first-ring suburbs that have felt the pain of new development passing them by and aging retail strips along its main corridor.
People don't gather anymore. They don't communicate in person anymore. And we need to really redefine that community. We have the infrastructure in place. You know, we're close to all the major highways. Many of those things that every first ring suburb has, we need to do a better job of taking advantage of it.
So communities that want to grow or at least tread water and stay even need to start looking a lot more at that where the growth is going to be is a lot more in single person households, households without children, whether that's young professionals or aging empty nesters.
As we began to identify our needs, it was apparent that we needed to encourage input from our residents. They have to be part of our process. They have to help us with what they want their community to look like.
The old time cities where you had a main street and you had really a village center. Gladstone has never had that. And that was a recurring theme over and over in these discussions. They wanted to have a central place that would be vibrant, that would be a place for them to connect.
The Gladstone community eagerly adopted a multi-year plan to reinvent its identity, starting with the community center as the cornerstone for its new town center.
There's loads of benefits to recreating centers. Suburban locations need a boost, and rather than continuing to direct development out to the edge, we really should be trying to redirect investment back inwards to some of those neglected properties that really already have the infrastructure in place and could also create centers.
In order to make the Gladstone Village Center a reality, the city chose 42 acres in the downtown area. They then purchased, demolished houses on the land, and began improving access from Highway 169.
And we've created this corridor between North Oak and the City Hall area where the new community center is and whatnot, sort of as a nice entryway into what we hope to be our village center.
And then we've bought buildings like the Gladstone 18 building. We're going to make that into a restaurant. We're going to start bringing people here. And you'll begin seeing an outdoor amphitheater, ice skating rink, and a tennis court.
Part of the master plan going forward is that people want that walkable community. That's not just about connecting sidewalks anymore. It's about creating a safe environment to walk. It's about it being convenient. Within our village center, people will be able to live here, they'll be able to exercise here. It will allow people not only to be more health conscious, but to be able to use that walkable, bikeable community to get to all of the services and all the amenities that they're looking for.
It's about creating an area that stands out in a whole community and a region as the place you want to be.
Learn more about plans for Gladstone at our website, imaginekc.org. In our segment, The Overview, we invite Kathleen Collins, photographer and president of the Kansas City Art Institute, to add some curatorial comments on a series of amazing aerial photographs of the metro taken by Alex McLean.
Since its beginning, the Country Club Plaza has set the standard for what we think of as a vibrant center. In this photograph, you can see its visual excitement. Beautiful tile roofs and hues of red and apricot set against stucco walls jump with color. Mosaic tiles adorn many of the buildings, reconnecting us with the architectural histories of Spain, Italy, and Mexico. The towers and cupolas are like exclamation marks against an already rich urban landscape. With its wide streets and lush landscaping, one should allow the time to really explore. Who wouldn't want to shop and dine in this fabulous area where you can almost imagine you're in a foreign country? From this aerial view, just for a moment, I can believe that I'm about to land in Seville, Spain.
Of course, the plaza was built long ago, and folks who create these places today face many different challenges. With us in the studio, we have representatives of two sides of the story. Ora Reynolds, president of Hunt Midwest Real Estate Development, the developer for Northgate in North Kansas City, and Mike Scanlon, the city administrator for Mission, Kansas. They're here to share with us some of the factors to consider and tools used to make these quality places a reality. So welcome, and Mike, I wanted to start with you and get your perspective on what the local community's role is in helping private developers develop these places.
There's really two roles that we play. The first is preparing the community for the type of development that's coming to the community, and we do that through our planning process and through community visioning. And then the second component is typically economic, in that especially in older communities where you have to do redevelopment, requires a developer to buy property and actually remove it from the tax rolls and try to redevelop it later.
Okay, and Aura, how does that work for you? What kinds of things is the city, what's that symbiosis?
We have a really great experience with a public-private partnership. Northgate Village was a public-private partnership with North Kansas City. And we went in there and basically had the vision and had figured that all out. And then it was, how do we lay this out? There was a surrounding neighborhood, and all we needed to do was fit into that area and keep the character. So we were there to kind of invigorate what was already there, create the connections, rather than to start from scratch. So I always say this about cities and municipalities. They need to incent what they want to happen, and then they need to fill in any kind of gap there is between the economics of what somebody's willing to pay for and the economics of what they want to see.
So speaking of incentives, what are some of the tools that you all need to kind of work through or offer one another in, you know, creating this plan?
Sometimes there's differences between Kansas and Missouri, but there's some that are sort of transcend the state lines and we all use them. Mm-hmm. Tax increment financing is one that you often hear talked about. Community improvement districts, which actually started in Missouri and have come to Kansas now. And then there's all kinds of what I call local incentives that we can offer in terms of helping them assemble property sometimes. Sometimes it's easier for the city to be the purchaser of property than it is the developer themselves in order to get enough properties put together.
What about like the codes and the, you know, I would assume that the old rules don't necessarily apply anymore.
I think you've seen it really in the last 5 years with the form-based codes being established throughout. And probably the most recent example would be Overland Park, who adopted a form-based code for a portion of Vision Medcalf in January. And now they're rezoning that downtown to fit it. Because what we find as we're looking at these older areas, where there has been conflict between neighborhoods and the old commercial districts, it was really, what's this going to look like and how is it going to impact my neighborhood? And so what a form-based code does is it says, we care more about what it looks like than how it functions in terms of its uses. And so I think form-based code will play a bigger role. And I think it also allows neighborhoods to get their opinions, at least surveyed as to what they want their community to look like as it moves forward.
You know, most cities, we were fortunate in North Kansas City that they had a lot of those codes already in place in those land use regulations. But what the challenge is often the communities don't have the densities approved. Right. And everything is focused on, is it 3 units to the acre, 4 units, and they're not focused again on what he said, on what it's going to look like.
So. And is the consumer or resident mindset changing a little bit?
I think there's generational changes that are occurring. I think I see some of my older residents that are looking for senior living, but not senior assisted. So they're looking for sort of like the Mission Square product that we have next to the community center. If I talk to my older daughter, who's about ready to get married, well, her first home will be the Safeway building across from the Freight House District.
Really, in a way, sustainability is how do you find a way to get somebody in your community or all day one when they're renting, you know, a market rate apartment, and then move them through all their lifestyles and life cycles. So and that whole intergenerational stuff is good. I mean, it's right. Good mm-hmm. for a community.
So if you look at Aura's families. Development in North Kansas City, that's what you'll see. You could actually live there your entire life, and you have all these different housing options. And so I think as we redevelop some of these older communities, that's what we're looking to replicate because mm-hmm. that's what people are starting to ask for.
Well, thank you both for sharing some of the ins and outs of planning and developing. It is a very complex process and quite fascinating too. And if you'd like more information, you can go to our website at imaginekc.org. But now we'll show you how some types of challenges and opportunities faced by older suburbs also come into play in emerging suburbs. Zona Rosa in the Northland off I-29 and Berry Road and Park Place near the Town Center Shops in Southern Leawood are two examples of how quality urban design principles guide the development of vibrant centers.
We have one of the most livable cities anywhere. It's a city in a forest. And if you get up very high at all and you look out, all you see are trees. And that's pretty cool. It's a cool place to live.
And what makes this such a livable city can be traced back in part to good planning by folks more than 50 years ago. Places like the Plaza, Brookside, and Prairie Village were built as models for walkable neighborhood living.
They're like small towns, and people like that.
In the mid-1950s, the pedestrian was pushed out by the automobile, and development followed suit with a boom of strip centers and car-centric design. So when planning began for regional centers like Park Place and Zona Rosa, designers pulled from old urban success and put it into new urban practice.
We're into the scale of the street. It's the 15 feet from the curb and the 15 feet up the wall. That's where the person lives, and that's the most important. And so most of the things we incorporate at Zona Rosa, we learn from walking the streets of Westport. We've always considered this block, Pennsylvania, to be the master urban planning block in Kansas City. So every time we get in a problem where we need to know a dimension, people always want to make things large, wider, and bigger. We run out here with a tape measure, and we measure the sidewalk. You know, you can measure this out, and it's 10 or 11 feet. Most people say you got to have 25 feet sidewalk. And it's like, okay, for what? So it's a lot of detail from the car to the person to the storefront and that whole interaction. This is one of my favorite spots, the little alley that cuts through. I actually tried to do that on a project once, and they just said, you know, I just can't live with anything that small. Planning over the years got more codified. People complain about traffic, and you go down this path for 10 or 12 years, and suddenly the car is the most important thing there is. So everything became strip centers. It's for the car. Zip in, zip out. We have engineers telling us that this corner needs to be large. We just come out here and measure it and say, well, it works in Westport. It's been working that way forever. You don't want people to be a slave to the automobile. It's that pedestrian zone we're trying to create. The buildings at Zona Rosa, I think these buildings are 56 foot between face of building to face of building. At Zona Rosa, it's 60 feet. So we made it just a little bit wider to give our trees a little more room to grow and things like that. We did squeeze the cars down. I think we have a 7 foot lane to park in and two 11-foot drive lanes, which is really, really tight. And thus people go, what? It's so hard to get around Zona Rosa, right? It's like, yes, that's exactly right. It's supposed to be that way. The pedestrian should rule.
It has a nice small town feel. Even though it's a really big area with a lot of great options, you still don't feel overwhelmed when you're walking through it because it's kind of compacted in a way that you can just see your options in front of you and then keep going.
So we come back to this street because of its scale. You know, there's one story, two story, three story buildings. The sidewalks are tight. They still have street trees and all the necessities, lighting and trash and all that. And so when we tell people a sidewalk can be 12 foot wide and they're thinking 25 feet, well, that just pushes the building farther apart, makes a scale change.
I really like Zona Rosa. It kind of reminds me of Westport, you know, and I don't have to drive all that way. And the feelings of the individual shops, you know, they all look different. It looks like a more of a modern downtown area. It's not the same, same, same.
Some of the oldest buildings in the city, they're not real fancy. It's the uniformity of the brick. It makes it soft and warm and nice. And so this is sort of our laboratory. It's where we get our confirmation that it works. People can't argue with it.
And developers on the other side of the metro agree. In Leawood, Kansas, the designers of Park Place are learning from the past. And once again, those sidewalks seem to be a key component.
The design of Park Place is really very calculated to make pedestrians feel comfortable when they're on the street. So what we have is we have a 24-foot wide street. Then we have two lanes of parallel parking on the street. And then on each side, we have a 20-foot sidewalk. Now, our sidewalks are designed so that the first 10 feet out from the building are a clear pedestrian path that makes it very easy for people to get in and out of the shops. Then the next 10 feet from that point out to the curb is what we call our cafe zone. That's where all of our outdoor dining occurs for our restaurants. It's also where we have our landscaping, and collectively, all those elements, including the height of the buildings, make up this outdoor room concept. They may not know why they like it, but they like it.
The design in Park Place is it's just all in one area. I mean, you just walk. We're gonna go get our nails done. We're gonna go get a cupcake. Don't have to drive anywhere.
I find this area just really charming. The shops are so unique. It's a great place to bring people from out of town, like an old-fashioned downtown.
As wonderful as a community as Leawood is, they knew they didn't have a downtown. They didn't have a gathering spot for their residents.
They had to be willing to approve the design that we put forth. They had to be willing to accept the higher density that was not characteristic of developments previously done in Leawood, and give us the signal that this was something that they truly wanted in their community. Well, I think we are absolutely a destination for a larger area because of the kind of design we have, because of the variety of shops and restaurants we have. We are a neighborhood center as well.
We wanted this to be a place that in 50, 80, 100 years, it still was a place that people liked to come.
So from some of the metro's most historic spaces to some that were empty fields just a few years back, we've shown you just a few examples of centers and how they work to make our region more vibrant, connected, and green. And that wraps up this episode. Be sure to visit our website at imaginekc.org. Thanks for watching.
Production of Imagine KC is made possible by the generous support of the Hall Family Foundation, the Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, the Garney Family Foundation Fund, Lafarge North America, the Urban Land Institute of Kansas City, and the Kansas City chapter of the American Institute of Architects. Imagine KC is a co-production of KCPT and the Mid-America Regional Council.